Harper Audio presents The Great Deluge. Hurricane Katrina, New Orleans, and the Mississippi Gulf Coast by Douglas Brinkley. Read by Kyf Brewer. Copyright 2006 by Douglas Brinkley. Production and abridgment copyright 2006 by HarperCollins Publishers. Because I was in New Orleans for Katrina, and later took part in boat rescues around Memorial Medical Center in Central City, this memoir, The Great Deluge, was possible. Eventually, I evacuated my family to Houston and interviewed people for days at the Astrodome. I have and always will have a highly personal stake in the Alabama, Mississippi, Louisiana, and Texas regions, which might color some of my judgments. My extensive eyewitness interviews helped me forge strong feelings about what went down on the plain of the Gulf South. But my job, as I saw it, was to chronicle the plight of others, not my own. Before the Gulf South can rebuild, it needs time to heal. It needs to take a breath, to pause, and to remember what transpired on August 29th, 2005, the day it was so gravely wounded. History, in the end, is homage. It's about caring enough to set the record straight, even if reliving the past is painful or disappointing. Buried history leads to rank defilement of the human spirit. Any politician involved with Katrina, who espouses the cliché that the blame game is unnecessary, is probably harboring a chestful of guilt. Nail them. At 5 a.m. on Saturday, August 27th, the National Hurricane Center, NHC, released an update from its headquarters in Miami. Advisory number 16 on the tropical storm named Katrina affirmed that with sustained winds of 115 miles per hour, the disturbance had already become a Category 3 hurricane, and, moreover, that some strengthening is forecast during the next 24 hours. Katrina was still about 350 miles out in the Gulf of Mexico. It had ripped through Florida as a Category 1 hurricane 2 days before, leaving approximately 500,000 people without power. According to Advisory 16, in fact, forecasters expected Katrina to turn west-northwest toward the city of New Orleans during the weekend. St. Charles's Parish's president, Albert LeKay, responded to the NHC advisory by issuing a mandatory evacuation order for all residents. A few other Louisiana parish presidents did the same that Saturday. When Plaquemine Parish President Benny Roussel declared a mandatory Phase 1 evacuation on August 27th, that Saturday when there was still plenty of time to flee, parish employees fanned out on pre-appointed routes, picking up residents with special needs and busing them to state-run shelters in Shreveport, Alexandria, Houma, and Lafayette. The parish not only knew which residents required special help, it knew exactly where they lived. "We were putting them on buses that Saturday morning, and you know what," Roussel recalled, "when we ran out of drivers, I went up to evacuees, determined which ones had valid driver's licenses and knew how to drive stick shift, and told them to bring folks north. They were tapped, deputized, or whatever you want to call it. They were now official parish drivers. Out, out, out. I wanted everybody out of Plaquemine Parish. We were able to get our people out." Throughout all 9 of Louisiana's coastal parishes, only a mandatory evacuation drew the attention of storm-tested residents. Anything less was inadequate. In New Orleans, Orleans Parish, no such mandatory evacuation order had ever been issued during the course of the city's 287-year history. This was not to imply that New Orleans had never before been in harm's way, the object of a natural disaster. In fact, it had never been out of peril. The city was founded in 1718 by the Sieur de Bienville, a French-Canadian nobleman who believed that the Mississippi River was in crying need of an ocean port. Bienville selected a tract of relatively high ground along an eastward curve in the Mississippi River. Bienville calculated that it was about 10 feet above sea level. It was probably not quite that high, but the site was distinctly above the surrounding waters in those early days. In his view, The site was a great natural port, allowing access to the river, which lay along the southern edge, as well as Lake Pontchartrain, about 3 miles to the north by way of Bayou St. John. During the first year, as Bienville was laying out the first roads in his new city with the help of 60 or 70 laborers, the Mississippi River swelled and put New Orleans, such as it was, under nearly a foot of water. The area's proclivity toward flooding worried Bienville. He immediately started work on the city's first levees, earthen berms that would protect the land from flood water. On September 23rd and 24th, 1722, the so-called Great Hurricane slammed into New Orleans, bringing with it an 8 to 10 foot storm surge. The town, for all practical purposes, ceased to exist. The stubborn Bienville would have saved a great many people future trouble if only he had abandoned the city right then and moved New Orleans inland. But there was an economic reason for keeping New Orleans where it was. In the 18th century, sailing a fully laden ship up a swift-flowing river such as the Mississippi was achingly difficult and, at times, utterly impossible. Sandbars were a particularly meddlesome navigation obstacle. For the sake of commerce, the port of New Orleans stayed put. There was money to be made in the burgeoning river port, and that's what mattered most. Traders were bolstered by unflappable engineers. The river, they insisted, could be tamed with the proper dikes and levees. Charged with keeping the city dry, the U.S. government did build miles of levees. The levees were to be foolproof bulwarks against both the seasonal flooding of the river and storm surges from the sea, via Lake Pontchartrain. Sometimes, however, those levees didn't work. In 1849, during the Mexican-American War, the collapse of one near the Carrollton neighborhood of uptown New Orleans sent a cascade of water surging through the Crescent City. Ultimately, more than 200 city blocks were inundated with floodwaters. For more than 6 weeks, New Orleans rotted, submerged underwater. The Great Storm of 1909 had Category 4 hurricane-force winds, causing Lake Pontchartrain to flood along the south shore, killing hundreds in the New Orleans area. In 1927, the city faced the wrath of the Great Mississippi Flood that devastated the lower Mississippi Valley. Still, for modern New Orleans residents, peace of mind came from the system of levees and flood walls that protected the city from surrounding water, whether from the lake, river, sea, or in the form of rain, the sky. New Orleans levee walls were typically 10 to 15 feet high, forming the sides of the saucer in which New Orleans sits. The system of levees was overseen by the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers, which had 1,300 employees in the New Orleans office. The New Orleans District of the Corps administered 30,000 square miles, all of southern Louisiana, the most complex section of the United States in terms of water control, and at the same time, the busiest, measured by shipping traffic. If engineering a reliable way to satisfy all the construction demands wasn't sensitive enough, the Corps also had to balance itself between the often conflicting interests of parochial Louisiana politicians and federal officials. What the national government ordered and what the locals insisted upon were nearly always different. The Corps itself was pushed and pulled just as much as any of the rivers or bayous that it oversaw. Because of the extraneous projects and inefficiencies that resulted, by 2005, it was overseeing a system of levees in New Orleans based on 50-year-old engineering and suspect construction techniques. Meanwhile, as the politicians bickered and the Corps dawdled, the threat of flooding in New Orleans constantly grew. Through coastal erosion and man-made engineering mistakes, nearly 1 million acres of buffering wetlands in southern Louisiana disappeared between 1930 and 2005. Louisiana lost coastal marshland in 20 parishes, a swath roughly equivalent to the acreage of Delaware. The reasons were many. As a result of the 1927 flood, the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers started channeling the Mississippi River, which had ugly, unintended consequences. Because the Mississippi was controlled by levees that kept it on one path, all of its sediment was deposited into the Gulf of Mexico, instead of spreading out along the coast, where it would build up in wetland areas. Another reason the coastline receded lay with the disruptive and long-lasting effect of massive construction projects. Oil companies installed miles of crisscrossing pipelines. Traditionally, oil was extracted from land or offshore, but new technologies allowed drilling in the coastal area, known as America's wetlands. Meanwhile, the government, under pressure from shipping interests, dredged channels, including the granddaddy of them all, the Gulf Intracoastal Waterway. Along some stretches, the intracoastal route followed natural waterways, but in the New Orleans section, it was man-made, a cement-sided canal cut into the soft marshland. Blocking the natural ebb and flow of the water, the intracoastal and other channels weakened the delicate ecology of the wetlands. Ongoing maintenance caused further damage. Together, industrial factors contributed to as much as 40% of Louisiana's total land loss. Over the decades, groups including the Sierra Club, Audubon Society, National Wetlands Research Center, and the organization America's Wetlands tried to sound alarms. Scientists believe that miles of coastal wetlands could reduce hurricane storm surges by over 3 or 4 feet. The historical record shows that Louisianans, like Senator John Brough, and certain responsible corporations, like Royal Dutch Shell, did care. But alas, not enough. Louisiana's ecosystem was dying, weakening every year with no miracle remedy in sight. Starting in the 1950s, millions of barrels of oil and trillions of cubic feet of natural gas were tapped from the Gulf of Mexico. Wetlands were lucrative. Pork barrel projects for the oil gas industry and Port of New Orleans always won the cash prizes. Louisiana Sierra Club Representative Daryl Malik complained in late 2005. The city of New Orleans desperately needed the levees and flood walls provided by the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers. According to research scientists at the University of New Orleans, the city had been sinking at the rate of 3 feet per century, due in part to the destruction of barrier islands and coastal wetlands. In addition, the ongoing effort to keep the city free of excess rainwater through the use of massive pumps, had weakened the underlying geology, accelerating the process engineers call subsidence. Basically, subsidence was the sinking effect that had taken hold of coastal Louisiana through a number of contributing factors, both natural, invasive flora-eating insect species, shifting subsurface faults, and man-made, dredging, canal digging, polluting. The net result was that instead of being slightly above sea level, as in Founder Bienville's day, New Orleans had sunk to an average of 6 feet below the waterline and as much as 11 feet in some parts of the Ninth Ward and Lakeview. In New Orleans East, the elevation was 8 feet below sea level. The real threat to New Orleans came from Lake Pontchartrain, north of the city, and from the primordial swamps that bordered it on the east and the west. Remarkably, the Mississippi wasn't much of a concern because the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers had built high-quality, sturdy levees along the river. The levees along the lake, however, were known to be more unstable. You could tell that by just looking at them. In geographical terms, New Orleans was and is no more stable than a delicate saucer floating in a bowl of water. Any turbulence in the surrounding water is bound to flood the saucer. In view of the city's close proximity to the Gulf of Mexico, turbulence in the surrounding area was inevitable. Most experts rank a hurricane in New Orleans with an earthquake in California and a terrorist attack on New York as the gravest threats to the nation. To make matters worse, the escalating carbon dioxide in the Gulf of Mexico, some scientists believed, was causing the ferocity of hurricanes to increase. Locals were certainly not ignorant of the looming danger of lethal hurricanes and storm surges jumping the levees, which formed the lip of the saucer. A steady stream of so-called doomsday treatises on the inevitability of a major hurricane laying waste to New Orleans were published in recent years. There was a landmark 5-part series by John McQuaid and Mark Schleifstein, published in June 2002 in the local Times-Picayune, titled Washing Away. The reporters didn't mince words. The big one would turn the city and the east bank of Jefferson Parish into a lake as much as 30 feet deep, fouled with chemicals and waste from ruined septic systems, businesses, and homes. Such a flood could trap hundreds of thousands of people in buildings and in vehicles. At the same time, high winds and tornadoes would tear at everything left standing. The series also warned of the high probability of the levees breaking. For decades, university professors all over Louisiana were desperately trying to get government officials to wake up to the dire threat. Many scenarios had been run prior to Katrina years ago, Gregory Stone of Louisiana State University's Coastal Studies Institute told BBC World Service. And with that type of storm, the scenarios should have been taken seriously. We'd been telling people all over the world that New Orleans was a nightmare waiting to happen. But New Orleans had so many urban problems, like inadequately funded schools, political corruption, and collapsing infrastructure, that it was near impossible to get locals to focus on barrier islands, wetlands rebuilding, and coastal erosion. While New Orleans residents often mused about the possibility of cataclysmic destruction, even if they were just whistling in the dark, their city remained starkly vulnerable. In 2005, it could not boast of a single shelter certified by the Red Cross, not one. That nonprofit behemoth, based on East Street Northwest in Washington, D.C., refused to operate a facility in New Orleans because none of the commonly used emergency sites, schools, hospitals, gymnasiums, etc., was much above sea level. The Red Cross would open up shelters outside the flood zone, but not in the saucer. Meanwhile, New Orleanians didn't even protest as their flood-prone hometown became a dumping ground for toxic waste.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.